my soul says, thank you. And yes to your will. Bless us now with your word. Write it upon the tables of our hearts. If there be anybody in the building who does not know you, I pray that they bow down before you. Allow you to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Strengthen those that are saved. Help us to fight the good fight of faith. Leaning not on our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledging you. Truly allowing you to direct our path. Take this old man out and crucify him. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh Lord, I pray my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of John, Gospel of John, the 5th chapter. I don't mind praising him because
yes, indeed. It's been good.
He's worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. I didn't come here today to impress anybody, but I came to worship him and to praise him.
To worship him,
to remember all over again that he is God, that he's God all by himself. The best thing I could do is just let him have his way in my life. So I'm giving honor to him. To our Savior Jesus the Christ, I thank God for Jesus' sake. Being up on the cross, it hurt. But what hurts him since it came off the cross is those who will not accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. I dare say that hurts him worse than the stripes that he took. Acknowledging the presence of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, for your spirit. I'm so grateful to have my friend, Harris Antwine. The beautiful words of praise and worship and service which have come from our youth. And I cannot tell you enough how much we need to encourage them because they are here and right now. Let them the Lord use. I mean, the book of John, the 5th chapter. Let's move on so that the Lord can preach this word in our hearts. The second verse. And now there he is at Jerusalem by the sheep market, a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk. The word impotent folk means they had some inabilities, they had some challenges. How many know we got some impotent folk in the spirit?
Come on, help us arise.
Y'all can touch that curveball. A blind and some halt, they were. The circle of life, they had suffered some withering limbs. Waiting, they were waiting for the moving of the water in the pool of Bethesda. Look what the Bible says. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. See, that's proof right there that just because the waters are troubled don't mean there's danger. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water, step in, was made whole of whatsoever disease, / withering, / blindness, that they may have had. And a certain man was there, which had the guy, you got this woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years, was a sad case. But look, this man had an infirmity for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The impotent man answered him, "Well, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another stepping down before me." Jesus said unto him, "Rise, take up thy bed, and walk." And immediately, not with a pause, and not later on down the road, but immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Lord have blessed with the witness, the humans, and the doers of his divine word. When Jesus saw him lie, he knew that he had been now a long time in that case. He said unto him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" As the Spirit of the Lord gives us utterance, I'm going to talk to you a little while from this Sunday. Is this what you really want? Say that with me. Is this what you really want? And as your secondary subject, you might want to use these words: a lame excuse. Thank you. A lame excuse. I was praying and meditating to the Lord as to what he would have me to say to the church, particularly on the eve of our fall revival.
All right.
And the Lord allowed me to go in the spirit down with Jesus to this pool at Bethesda. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to travel with him, and might I tell you that I looked out in the spirit and saw there around the pool a magnificent sight. I saw five porches.
Yeah.
I saw the beautiful waters. But what was more impressive than the five porches and the beautiful water was I could see that there were hundreds of people who had gathered around the pool of Bethesda. And they were all there waiting. It was both a marvelous sight, a grand congregation, but yet at the same time it was somewhat sad and disheartening that so many had endured so much in life. And whether you know it or not, everybody, including those in this congregation, have been through some hard times in life. You don't have to be an old man to talk about pain and struggle. You don't have to be an old woman to talk about some time in the valley.
Come on.
I remember that even as a teenager, I had some stormy days. As a young adult, I had some very perilous nights. And now even after being saved after all of this time, after being pastoring all of these years, I can still testify that sometimes it gets a little tough.
Amen.
You can find yourself at times crying in the late night hour. So I want you to understand that it must have done something to my spirit in order to see this great and large gathering of people who I knew had gone through some things. And my heart was sad because I knew that they were representative of all of mankind. With all of our various struggles. So I traveled with Jesus in the spirit. We get closer to the pool down in Bethesda. And I see him as he walk over toward a man who sits there on the ground as he was. I wish you could have been there to see the sight. Saw him there with all of his stuff around him. He had some water to drink. He had some food to eat. He even had a pillow to lay on. And when I looked at him in the spirit, I deemed to myself, it just seemed to me that this man was there and looked like he had not just gotten there yesterday, but looked like he had been there a long time. And I want you to know sometimes you need to really check yourself, and I need to check myself, and we all need to check one another. Because you can be in a place for a long time, longer than you even expected. Some of you have been in a relationship a long time. You thought you was going to be out of that a long time ago. Some of you are single. And you've been single a long time. And it's beginning to disturb you because you thought you could get somebody just like that. But here, after all of these years, after all of this time, you're still in the same place. Some of you swore that you were going to leave that job years ago. But you're still there, checking in and checking out. Some of you have said, you know, spiritually, I'm going to be way up there on the mountaintop. One of these days, I'm going to study and know the word of God for myself. One of these days, I'm going to be in a place where the devils are going to tremble when I step into the room. But even today, after all these years, hell is still laughing at you. I saw this man sitting there. And he was looking at Jesus. Almost as though he had heard that Jesus might be able to heal. And I anticipated in the spirit. Y'all pray with me here. Somebody already had lived in La La Land.
I'm not.
Right? I anticipated that in the spirit that Jesus would reach out to him and immediately touch his body and raise him up. See, I was confident to the evidence that Jesus could heal him. Faith in me declared that Jesus had all power in heaven and in earth in the palm of his hand. And I just knew that Jesus was going to just reach out and touch and heal him. And then the man would stand up and start shouting and rejoicing and testifying and tell everybody there, you ain't got to get in the water because here is one that's a doctor that has never ever lost.
Come on, come on, come
out and touching him and healing him. No, Jesus asked him a question.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all staying in this room?
Come on, come on.
I need you to hear what I'm saying. That Jesus asked him a question. And in my mind, the question that Jesus asked him was an elementary question. It didn't one that required a whole lot of study. It wasn't a question that you had to be in a high elite to understand. It wasn't a question of complexity, but rather one very simple and vague. I was amazed that Jesus would even ask him the question, because immediately in my mind, I would have answered right away his answer, the question. Jesus asked the man this question. He said to him, do you want to be made whole? I saw on ESPN one day, Brother Polo, whatever, they said, come on, man. And when they said, come on, man, they tried to tell you that man, that this was an easy thing that you done messed up on. And I wanted to tell the man immediately, come on, man. And I wanted to look at Jesus, why are you asking this man this question? Do you want to be made whole? And suddenly I realized that this man had been in this condition for over 30 years. The Bible says 38 years. He had been lame and unable to rise up, unable to go about and be like everybody else, unable to go and do things that a normal man would do. He had been afflicted. He had been down. He had been lame for 38 long years. And Jesus, after 38 long years, you would ask him, do you want to be made?
Hello.
Oh. And suddenly, the moment froze. You ever have a moment in your life that time was really moving, but it really kind of froze? And for a moment, even though it continued to move on, I froze and I stopped right there. And I heard what Jesus asked him, do you want to be made whole? And suddenly, the devil jumped in me. Somebody up right
there.
Suddenly the devil jumped in me and I said, hold on a moment. Before you answer the question, before you give an easy answer, I want to play the devil's advocate. Let me argue the case, because I know what you're going to say. You're going to tell Jesus, yes, I want to be made whole. Yes, I want to be restored. Yes, I want to walk. Yes, I want to be like every ordinary man. Yes, heal me right now and right on the spot. But I got a message. I got messy and I began to sit there and I told that man, I said, now before you answer, before you give Jesus a response, I need you to understand something. Let me qualify your answer even before you give it, because I don't want you to give Jesus an answer that you really don't mean.
Come on, help us out.
Because some of you are just like the man that was lame. Some of us are just like him. We keep on praying year after year, moment after moment, hour after moment, decade after decade, that the Lord would bless us with something, that he brings change and revival in our lives. But when it really boils down to it, we don't really want.
No.
Oh,
come on now.
Y'all not praying.
Yeah. Help us.
What you've been praying for. You don't really want what you've been crying for. You don't really want, you know. And so I had to pause him and tell him, before you answer, make sure that your answer is correct, because I've got some questions about your answer. And so the moment it paused for me, and Jesus allowed me in the spirit the chance to buffet this man's soul.
Right.
He allowed me a moment in the spirit.
Come on.
Yeah.
to challenge his easy answer. Because I knew he was going to fix his lips to tell Jesus yes. I knew he was going to say quick, fast, and hurry. I knew he was going to go for the easy and the right answer, the correct answer, the morally good answer, the answer that made him look good in the eyesight of others, the answer that everybody would have expected him to say. I knew he was going to say, yes, I want to be made whole. But I told him, wait a minute, before you answer it, let me ask this question.
All right.
Let me remind you,
yes.
Mr. Lame Man.
Yes.
You have been here for 38 years.
Yes.
And in 38 years, this is all.
Help us this morning.
Right.
I'm not somebody that's going to leave me on this message, because this is a powerful message and it is relevant to all of our lives. This is all you know. For 38 years, you have built your comfort zone right around this pool. You don't get what I'm saying. For 38 long years, you have been in this situation. You know all about this spot that you're in. You have become a specialist in sitting. You have become a specialist in begging. You have become a specialist in not expecting to be here. You have become a specialist in navigating life on these terms. But if you're being made whole today, you're going to have to enter into a place where you have never ever been.
God the glory with this, if you can't be honorable with this, why
You ain't ready for it. Amen. The Lord is losing me to tell you this. To show you how relevant this is.
Yeah.
I spoke to a young lady some years ago.
Yeah.
And she said to me, "Pastor, pray for me." Y'all still with me?
Come on.
Oh, yeah.
Pray for me because I believe that if God would just bless me with a good man.
Come on.
Come on.
Now y'all stop all that frowning.
I ain't frowning.
Because secretly, you've been praying for a good man. And you got a man.
Hello.
I'll drink to that. What I said was, because some of you got caught in the middle of an amen and didn't hear what I said. What I said was, some of you are praying for a good man and you already got a man.
Come on.
You know what I'm saying? It's a hard thing to be praying for a good man and you sleeping with the enemy. Because I believe if I had a good man in my life, and then it would help me to be able to grow as a Christian. It would help me to be a better person. I won't be distracted. I won't get caught up in some things. Just pray for me that the Lord will bless me with a good man. And I looked her in the eye, and with all due love for her, I had to say to her, "Baby, you don't want a good man."
Come on.
I understood that the Lord had spoken to me and told me clearly, she ain't ready for no good man. And everybody said, "Well, I feel like I'm ready for a good man. Why you say I'm not ready for a good man?" That's what she asked me. And you know what the Lord told me to tell? He said, "Well, if the Lord gave you a good man, let's see how you would respond to a good man." I said, "Well, why you want a good man? Tell me why." She said, "And that way I can go to church with you." Y'all stop saying "ah." I know you wish your man to come to church with you.
Yeah, you know you want
it. I see no women in here than men. That's all I'm saying. "Yeah, I would go to church with him." I said, "You go to church with him every Sunday?" "Every Sunday." "Praise God, little Mary Sunday." "Yeah, every Sunday." Y'all would pray together all the time. All the time. If I had a good man, then I could be a better woman. And so I had to say, "Well, hold on a moment. Let me ask you some questions." Touch your neighbor and say, "Can I ask you something?" "If you had a good man, let me ask you, do you still like to go to the club sometimes?" Hold on, I'm going to turn my back.
No, no good man.
Some of my older ladies are saying, "No, I don't go there no more now." "Do you like to go to the trail rides?" She said, "Well, Pastor, I must admit, I still like to go to the club sometimes." So I said, "Now, if you're going to the club, You know, things gonna get hopping until after 10 or 12 o'clock. And so if you go to the club on Saturday night, what kind of condition are you going to be in to go to Sunday morning worship service? Y'all might say, say amen. I don't think you know what you're talking about. And so she said, well, you make a good point, Pastor. They make a good point, Pastor. So therefore, if he came and knocked on your door every Sunday morning, do you really think you're going to go to church every Sunday morning? But she said, well, why not? You make a good point right there. And probably a couple of, maybe two Sundays after the month or so, I probably won't be in any condition to go to the church. So you're right, it's a good, but I still want a good man. I said, well, hold on a second. Before you declare that and put that in your spirit, let me ask you another question. If God blessed you with a good man, that's all right, baby. I pray God give you a good man. If God gave you a good man, and he brought you some flowers, how would you feel about that? She said to me, oh, Ram, that would really make my heart feel good. Y'all about to let the baby listen to the message. Caught you! And now listen. He brought you some flowers. Would you like that? She said, yes, I would love it. He brought me some flowers. And it would make my heart go pitter-patter-patter. I would feel extra special. I said, but hold on a moment. Wait a minute. Those answers that you are returning to me are too easy and too simple. I want you to put it in real time. I want you to really think about what it is I'm saying. I'm saying to you, if out of the blue, not because it was your birthday or not because it was your anniversary, not because it was some special day, if out of the blue, he walked up to you and brought you a bouquet of 6 dozen roses or a dozen roses, how would you feel about that? She said, I'm telling you, man, I don't feel good about that. But I said, well, hold on a moment. Have you gotten flowers all the time? No, I never get flowers. See, that's why I want a good man. I said, well, hold on a minute. If he brought you some flowers from out of the blue, how would you really feel? Stop and think about what I said. She said, well, I'd have to ask him, well, would you leave it?
Yeah.
You didn't hear what I said?
Oh, yeah.
If you just out of the blue, if he just out of the blue brought me some flowers and gave them to me, said, baby, I just want to tell you I love you and gave them to me and kissed me, then I would have to ask myself the question, what is he up to? What did he do? Who is he cheating on me with? What's really going on? But I'm trying to help you understand that sometimes we're praying for things that we really don't understand.
All right.
If God would bless us, we would be the ones that would mess them up. The end of our conversation, the young lady had to tell me, but I never thought of it like that. Maybe it would do me better to pray that God would make me a good woman and then send me a good man. I was in messy mode. Got some folks laughing because they understand what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I say messy mode because I didn't want this lame man to give Jesus some kind of lame answer. I didn't want him to just give him what's off the top of his head or just what's out of his feelings, but I wanted him to dig deeper. So I asked the lame man, I said, do you not understand that if Jesus healed you today, it's going to require you to enter into a world that you have never, ever experienced before? Right now, it's been okay for you to sit around all day. Some folk around here talking about they want a job, but they don't really want to get up and have to go to work. You don't hear what I'm saying? You're talking about if God just blessed me with a job, but baby, you ain't had a job in a couple of years. You've been living off a woman for a while now, and it's going to be hard for you to change your comfort zone and rise up and get out and put yourself to work. So before you pray for a job, make sure you're ready to work. If Jesus heals you, makes you whole, it's going to change your comfort zone.
Yeah. Amen. That's it.
How many know that there is a spiritual comfort zone? Thank you, sister. I appreciate you. There is a spiritual comfort zone. And then the reality is, most of us, if not all of us, are in a spiritual comfort zone. Now, we sit up here praying, talking about, Lord, revive me. Lord, restore me. Lord, energize me. Lord, set me on fire. But the reality is, if you was in some fire, you would have to dance. That's what I'm saying. If you was in some fire, it's going to make you move. If you was in some fire, it's going to make you jump.
Change
Because up to this point,
yes,
for at least almost 38 years ago, he has been hanging around lame folk.
Yes. Uh-huh. Oh, yes.
Right. Amen. Right about
it. I believe somebody already is going to be in the spirit.
Right about it.
Now, up to this point, he's been hanging around some lame folk. And the reason why some of us are handicapped today is because we are hanging around some lame folk. Amen. I know you're hanging around some lame folk because when I read your Facebook post, but boy, you know how to burn up that telephone.
Come on now.
Cut all my phone
off. Listen to me. You could be physically whole.
Come on.
And still lame.
Yeah.
Especially if you're hanging around some lame folk. Folk around you sick.
Yeah.
And ain't nothing wrong with you. But you feeling some kind of way. Shout my family here. You're wondering why it is that you've been losing your joy. You better check your lame folk. You've been wondering why it is that you're always in some mess.
Yes, sir.
You're now to check your circle of friends because you've been hanging around some lame folk. But I got to tell you, I dare you today to allow Jesus to heal you. Because if he heals you, you're not going to hang around lame folk, but you're going to hang around some folk that got to get up about themselves. Some folk that got to be eating about themselves. Some folk that got some strength in the legs and some strength in the spirit.
What about it?
That's why I don't need all out there like other folk.
All right.
Because there's a lot of dry bones in the valley. And you can be healthy and well. But you hang out for 38 years around you. Dry bones. And you'll begin to see you'll start looking a little peaky. Start getting a little thin. Because birds are a feather. Y'all not afraid of me, huh? See,
Jesus to be your captain if you ain't ready to be healed. Every deed done in his body. So I told that man, I argued with him. I argued with the lame man and told him, before you answer the question that Jesus asked, make sure you're ready for the change of the world.
All right.
Better make sure you're ready for a new atmosphere.
Yes.
And how many know God will change your atmosphere?
Yes.
And when the Lord changes your atmosphere,
yes,
that will change your circle of friends.
Yes.
That will break down your comfort zone.
Yes.
And that will require you to be accountable.
Yes.
For what the Lord has done. And part of the Lord changing is that you give him the glory. And so, if you're not ready to give the Lord the glory, then you're not ready to be healed. And that's not just giving him the glory sometimes, but that's giving him the glory all the time. Realizing that it was not by your might nor by your strength, but by the Lord's grace and the Lord's mercy that you are delivered. Can I get a witness here? And I told a man there, a lame man, that if Jesus can heal you, I hope you can answer all my questions. And when Jesus asked him the question, suddenly he took it off pause and went back into the real time. I heard the man say, you see, I've been here a long time. Oh, Lord. I heard him begin to give a lame excuse. You see, around this pool, there are many people. And I've come here because the word is that any man sick, when the water is troubled, in the water, the angel of the Lord would heal his body. Oh, Lord, and I wish I had somebody in here today who could still believe that the Lord can work it out for you. Oh, Lord, and no matter how long you've been down by the pool, sometimes you gotta encourage yourself and say he may not come when you want him, but heaven, remind yourself that the Lord you serve is always on time. Oh, Lord, you need to remind yourself that God is not through with you yet. Oh, Lord, you need to encourage yourself and say that weeping endures for the night, but joy, it comes in the morning. Well, I heard when the man said, oh yeah, but whenever I try to get to the waters, oh Lord, there's always somebody that beats me stepping in the pool. Oh yeah, this morning to tell somebody, ain't nobody can take away your blessing. No, there's no man woman, boy, girl, who can take from you what God have in store? Can I get one witness? Tell somebody, oh yeah, what's mine in the Lord? It's mine, oh Lord. God, a blessing with my name written on it, oh no. And the devil in hell don't have an eraser that he can erase it out, oh no. I may not get it today, oh no, but sooner or later the Lord will. Yes, amen. Your lame excuse. I didn't need your history. I don't need all of these things. What I want to know is all these things. Can you tell me? Do you want? Do you want? Do you want to be made? I heard Jesus say, rise and take up your bed and go on out here. Rise about your mentality. Rise from your comfort zone. Rise out of your familiarity. Rise and realize that who in front of you, it's greater than he in the world. Yeah, no more lame excuses, no more simple excuses. But I tell you, if you really want to be made whole, rise.
Feeling
in need, Lord, is able. But last night,
now.
Yeah. Getting ready.
Ready.
To come here today.
Yeah.
Yeah. Got up in the morning. Shame in my hand. Thinking about.
Yeah.
What happened last night.
Yeah.
That you want to revive. Preacher, are you sure that you're ready for change? It might change your whole life. It might change your whole world. Oh, it might change your whole mind. Before you ask God for revival, make sure. That's what you really want.
Yeah.
And it's strength. How the wind can change on you. One day, you're pointing down at somebody. And the next day, you're looking up to them. And it's strange how time can turn around. The one that was rich can become poor. The man that was poor can become rich. I was so shocked when I saw that man coming into my room. He told me, before you ever ask God for revival, make sure.
I gotta tell you that if you're gonna pray to God for something,
make sure
that you really want it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Ain't no use to pray. Stop promising God.
Come on.
He can count on you. Stop vowing to the Lord that if it brings you change, you'll run for him.
Come back in the mouth.
Yes.
The Lord allowed him to look into my face.
Yes.
See, I don't care nothing about your preaching.
All right.
Don't make no difference to me.
Yes.
What kind of robe you wear.
All right.
Your tenure as pastor.
Yes.
The
number of years you've been saved.
Yes.
Don't mean nothing to me.
Amen.
All of those are some lame excuses.
Yeah, all right.
What I really want to know is, do you really, truly want to abide? Do you really, truly want change?
Yes.
And before you go hollering yes, you better make sure you can answer the same question that you asked me. I heard the man look me in my eye and say, I'm not sure, preacher, if you are ready for this.
All right.
Because you've been happy with that. Now that's what I'm going to ask you, ask me extend the invitation. It sure sounds good. You're praying to the Lord for this. Sounds good that you've been fasting. Sounds good that you've been sacrificing. It's quite impressive that you pray every day and sometimes several times. But Jesus asked James and John, can you drink of this cup? Talking about you being greater. One on the left, one on the right. But can you drink from this cup? As you read for yourself, what might be in store for you? The Lord came and told me that. Are you really ready for this?